kids, we need to talk. The stove thing has gotten out of control. If you ask the manufacturers of stoves, they will tell you that their product is good for everything. But what the hell are they actually good for? This is my collection of stoves. I thought I'd talk through what they do, why I have each one. You can use that to help you select which stove or what type of stove is going to work best for you. Let's just talk through it, give you the high level of each type of cooking setup. You can figure out what you want to take with you. Just to give you the bottom line up front, you're going to go with an alcohol stove if you're going for the very lightest option. You're going to go with something with a wider base and flame shooting around the outside of the burner instead of straight up the middle if you're trying to go with something that's gourmet type cooking. And if you're going to go in the middle or you just want like quick and easy canister stove, you'll go ahead and use this. This gives you a little bit of ability to simmer, but it's not quite that great. It's still hot spot in the middle like this guy and doesn't give you the ability to refill your bottle if it's half full. A lot of thru-hikers use this for that reason because they don't really care about refilling their fuel bottle ones halfway. They'll just use a couple of these until they're gone. All of these work better with a wind guard. I'm just showing you this way because it's easier to see the actual thing. For a wind guard, you'll use some folded up aluminum foil. You're good to go. As for a cooking vessel, if you want the lightest option, you'll go with something like this. It's just a titanium cup or a titanium mug, probably 550 milliliters. That's big enough to handle most things, but you don't have any extra room in there. You're not going to do like a whole package of macaroni and cheese in this. If you're going to do larger volumes of food or you're going to do something that's semi-gourmet every once in a while, a medium-sized pot like this that's 850 milliliters to, we'll say, 1.2 liters might be good. Or you get this, and then if you're going to do like fish or something like that, you bring along a pie plate that you've seasoned that you can use as a fry pan with a little something like this that can grab on the edge. And if you were going full gourmet, my opinion, fry bake is the way to go. You can also do the pan with this guy over top, your call, but I think this is a superior piece of equipment. Just my two bits. So let's get into it. Let's start with a fairly standard option. This is the basic single burner, isobutane propane, canister stove. This is a titanium cheapo one, BRS model. It was, I think, 15 bucks and it weighs less than an ounce. Seems to work fine. I don't know what it's like in terms of fuel efficiency, and I'm far too lazy to test that considering this isn't my primary stove. But this is a good option if you're just going out by yourself or with friends and you want something that's really convenient. It tends to concentrate the heat in the middle. If you're cooking in a pot like this, it's great. But if you're going to try to use something like this to try to cook some fish, you're just going to have a hot spot in the middle and it's not going to work that great. It'll be okay and it'll be better than an alcohol stove in that respect, but it leaves something to be desired. Now, if you're going to use one of these things, definitely going to want to have is one of these, a wind guard. These little single burner butane stoves tend not to work very well in the wind. And a good way to get around that is just, this is literally just folded up aluminum foil. When you put it around the burner like this, you want to make sure that you're protecting the canister, because if that canister overheats, this whole thing turns into a bomb. Not saying it's fairly common, but I'm saying that it's possible and you need to be aware of it as a risk. Also, since people tend to use these things with a lightweight titanium pot, something that if you're new, you might not have seen before is aluminum foil lids. Older school people will use these because they weigh less, easily replaced, folded up so it takes up less space. It doesn't save that much weight, but it is something that many people do. And that is isobutane propane stove. Now, while I've got this thing out, let's talk about the issue with this in the winter. One way to get around that is to get another container like this. Put just a little bit of water in there, enough to fill it up maybe halfway to 2/3 of the way up the tank. And what that does is the water is going to keep that fuel warm. If you're going to spend a lot of time out there in the winter, you might be better off just using a different option. And we'll get into some of those options in a minute. Before we get into the cold weather stuff, though, let's talk about the lightest option you're going to have. And that's going to be something like this. Well, let's backtrack a little bit. Your absolute latest option is going to be to use bars or just cold soaked foods, things that you don't even have to cook at all. That said, I've never really gotten into it. I've tried it. When you try to rehydrate things, they don't quite fully rehydrate most of the time. And if you do try to get them to rehydrate, you end up having to have them soak for so long that you end up carrying more weight just because you're carrying a bottle full of water with stuff soaking in it. So I see it as a waste. It's not really worth it. If I'm going without a stove, I'm just going to carry bars. I've done it before, but it's not ideal. It's usually if I'm trying to go really fast. And these days, I just don't care that much about going fast. I still go like 20 plus miles in a day, but I don't try to really push it. So this is an alcohol stove. This is your lightest cooking option. Now, there are different variations on this setup. I use pot stand and a little titanium stove. You can make your own. A very popular one is the cat can stove. It's literally made out of a fancy feast can. Pretty much anything that holds alcohol will work as a burner. Alcohol burns so clean that you're not going to end up with anything too sooty as long as you're using yellow heat or denatured alcohol, which is great, but just spoiler alert, you can't get that in California anymore. They decided that it was too dangerous or whatever. I don't know. I'm all for the environment, but that seems a little ridiculous. So the way that this guy goes together is you've got stove, this is, or burner, I should say, then pot stand, aluminum foil around it, throw that guy on top. You can throw a little alcohol in there, light it. Now, some people, you have two options for getting this lit really conveniently. You can either dribble a little bit of fuel on the edge, or you can just carry matches, which is what I usually do, and get down in there without having to tip my lighter upside down and burn my knuckle. But it's also just as easy an option to dribble a little alcohol on the side so that you can light the alcohol there without having to catch your thumb on fire. This actually is the lightest cup I've got. I think it's from MLD. Really all you need, just something that will withstand the heat. This rubber band around the outside works reasonably well in terms of giving you something to hold on to without burning yourself. Sometimes it will be nice to have something like this, which is just an ultralight pot grabber from MSR. And that'll help you out in grabbing this if you're ginger about the heat. Having a little silicone band around the outside, I've never had a problem. And yeah, that's pretty much it. One of these guys is pretty simple. And your next step up on Maslow's pyramid of comfort is probably going to be something like this, at least in my opinion. Now this is, you're no longer boiling things, you're doing proper cooking, but you're still fairly lightweight. I use a remote canister stove, something with a very broad foundation on it, which is something that you're using one of these little guys, you can't get that much width on it to hold a bigger pot or a big fry pan. If you're trying to go real light and you just wanted something like this so you could cook fish, just a pie pan like this, the black coating on the inside of it is seasoning, the same way that you'd season a cast iron pan. You put down layers of oil and you really bake it on there solid. It makes a nice nonstick coating. This is probably your lightest option in terms of a fry pan. However, if I'm gonna take this setup, I usually take this guy, which is my fry bake. Now, the Banks fry bake is like an old school classic. I don't know when they started making them, but Knowles, National Outdoor Leadership School, uses these. They use the larger version. I use this is the Alpine Deep version, which I think is the best way to go. If you use the NLS cookbook, which I suggest you do take a look at if you want to have real cooking in the outdoors, if you go that route, then it's going to be the perfect size for half of one of those recipes or a normal two-person size recipe. It also allows you to use this lid with a stick fire on top. You can actually bake things. You can do nice cobblers and things. It's great. Especially nice if you're just planning to go up for a few days on a weekend with some friends and you want to really enjoy you're eating. So Banks fry bake is a great way to go. You can also use this, just looking at the black on it, you can probably tell I've used this a fair amount on an actual campfire just as a Dutch oven. And I will sometimes take this, leave the stove at home, or take it with a different setup. Most often I will use this setup together. One thing that's really nice about this stove, it does have the remote canister on it. If you're using something with a wide base like this, you can use a much larger wind guard that goes all the way around the burner. And this allows you to funnel that heat up around the base of a larger pan like this. Otherwise, if you were to use a smaller wind guard on this, you'd be in there only be magnifying the problem with the heat being concentrated in one spot. Something to note about this, you do have the jets on this going around the side. That also helps spread out the flame on a larger pot. However, I consider a burner like that to be a disadvantage when you're working with a little pot like this. Not only because this is clearly the stand isn't designed to work with it, but the flame shooting out the side is going to wrap around the sides of the pot, and you don't want that. You want the heat shooting directly into the bottom, and that's how you're going to transfer the most heat into this container. With that in mind, it's ideal for this, and if you're cooking a Sierra-sized trout, it was 8 to 12 inches, and after you trim it up, it's 6 to 8 inches, sometimes shorter. One of these pans will be perfect for you. You can cook up a few trout in it, and you can have some peach cobbler. I think this is a good gourmet option when you're still trying to be fairly lightweight. I use this on weekend fishing trips in the Sierra all the time, and I love it. One last note, the Banks Fry Bank guys sell this metal spatula. It's pretty great. It has a fairly sharp edge on it, which means you can scrape out this pan fairly well. I don't think I've ever really washed this. I just scrape it, and it comes out clean enough. The only thing that I might end up doing with it is it doesn't fit all the way in. I think they designed this to work with larger ones. I think they've got a 12-inch in diameter. This is an 8-inch in diameter. I might chop this down just so it'll fit inside the pot. I don't want to have it loose in my pack. This edge can be kind of pokey. Spatula, though, totally worth it. It scrapes really well, and you'd be missing out on one of the major advantages of this hard anodized coating they have on here if you weren't using a spatula like this. Now, at this point, I can actually hear people through the internet complaining. I haven't shown them a jet boil yet as one of the best options. And there is a home for that, but it's not day-to-day backpacking. That's the thing. That big heat exchanger and all this stuff just isn't necessary for day-to-day backpacking. It's too much weight. Sure, you're going to boil your water in 2 minutes instead of 5 minutes, but you're backpacking, man. Like, how much time do you really need? When you do need that is in the winter. Reason being, all the water is frozen. If you want water, you gotta heat it up. And that's when you need something that's really fuel efficient and will heat up water extremely fast. I've boiled 2 cups of water in this in 1.5 minutes. You have to actually be careful when you use one of these things at full blast with only 2 cups of water in it. You can boil all of that water off in an incredibly short period of time. Proper procedure for this is you get a little splash of the water that you already have. You should never wait until you're totally out of water before you start doing this. You put a little splash of water in the bottom, and then you just pack this thing full of snow. You put the whole thing on top of the catalytic burner there, you light it up, and you let all that melt down in there. And then you pack more snow in, and you keep doing that. You need the extra capacity because snow takes up a lot more space than water does, so you're gonna dump a lot of snow in here, and it's just gonna keep melting down and melting down and melting down. Downside of one of these guys is that you need to keep this canister warm enough for it to keep working in the winter. If you have canisters that have a meaningful content of N-butane, when you put this thing down in the snow, it's gonna chill, and then it's gonna stop working. It may not completely go out, but you'll notice that the output isn't really enough to heat things up anymore. So what you have to do in that instance, grab a little pot of some kind and drop just enough water to fill up maybe halfway to two-thirds of the way up the canister. As long as that water is still liquid, it's warm enough to keep that N-butane so it continues to maintain pressure in the stove. That's where this guy falls in. This is really a winter tool. This is not something I would not use an integrated stove in the summer at all because it's just too much weight. This altogether weighs more than my fancy cooking setup. I just can't justify it. It is still an option and a good option. You're out there in the winter and you just need to boil a bunch of water. You know what? I lied. There's one more case where this is useful, and that is if you're in an area that's super, super windy. This could be the face of a giant rock wall, or it could be on top of a really exposed glacier or peak. Most of the time, I'm not going to try to set up shop on something like that anyways, so it just didn't come to mind. Rock climbers or people who are doing that sort of thing probably care a little bit more about these things. They also care a lot more about weight than even backpackers. So it's just another use that I hadn't given adequate time to. That's not most use cases. That's not most people who buy it, because I think that there are a lot of backpackers who buy it thinking that it's a good backpacking stove. And generally speaking, I would suggest other things first. It's not bad. It still works. It boils water. Maybe not the best tool for the job. The last thing I'm going to talk about is a white gas stove. These aren't going to be the thing that most people need, because usually most people are going to go backpacking in onesie-twosie type groups and not in larger groups of people. And that's where this thing really shines. If you need to go backpacking with 3 or more people, it's probably weight efficient to take one of these things, just because the white gas that it uses is so much more energy dense. This becomes more of an issue if you're, say, going out as a group in the winter. Maybe you're going on a ski mountaineering trip or something like that. That's when this is going to be more useful. You're going to go through so much fuel melting water. Using a canister stove would just become impractical. The white gas is, by comparison, extraordinarily cheap. A gallon of the stuff will probably cost you between $10 and $20. Just throwing this out as another option. It's not going to be the best for most people, but if you're a Boy Scout troop, you've probably already heard of this, but if for some reason you're going out with a large group, it makes sense. I mean, these guys approve, so it works for that sort of situation. Just throwing that out there as another option, but unless you're going with a big group, I'd not worry too much about this guy. The other option in this area is, the major options are all from MSR. I have the Coleman one because I think it starts more easily. This thing is also ancient. The newer version they have, it's not as light, but it's probably okay. I just haven't bothered to get it because this thing still runs. The Coleman stoves are all the white gas stoves, really. They're just bulletproof. You buy one, it'll last you a lifetime. The MSR ones, I like the Dragonfly because it has a large base if you're going to cook for a big group, which is often where this thing shines. The XKG as well is also good in that situation. However, with the XKG and the Dragonfly, they are ungodly loud. So keep that in mind if you're getting one, be aware, it's going to sound like a jet engine, which is, you know, disturbing if it's just a couple people out there, but if you have a large group, you're going to be making so much noise anyways that it doesn't matter. The Whisper Light is the similar offering from MSR, and that's actually what NLLS uses. They also prefer it because this has the gas tank attached to the bottom. If something goes wrong and you flood this and the whole thing catches on fire, it can also turn into a bomb, just like the isopropane tanks. That's why MSR moved the bottle to be separate, and I think that's why Knowles uses it too, because it is safer. I haven't found it as safe because I find the connection between the stove and the bottle sometimes leaks, which creates more of a risk of a fire. It's just, I guess, not a catastrophic one. Whatever. As I said, I think this guy starts a little easier. I will take it sometimes if it's me and my girlfriend and we want to do a lot of like gourmet cooking where there's simmering and things like that. And first off, it has a relatively large burner element, so that heat is already spread out a little bit, and you have the ability to throttle it down really low. So you can simmer this guy really nicely and put low and slow heat on something in a way that you just can't with other stoves. If you want to do like a lot of baking on a stove, which is a thing, use the fry bake and put a little stick fire, or you can use a couple pie pans put together, maybe just a fry pan and put a pie pan over top and put a stick fire on top of that. The fry bake is a slightly better package overall, but that sort of approach works as well. And that's what I used until I got the fry bake. Anyway, for large groups, this is great. Otherwise, unless you're going to do a lot of gourmet cooking, you probably want to leave it at home. Probably the last thing, which I almost wasn't going to get into in this video, was cooking over a fire. For that, all you really need is something like this. Good enough pot. Clearly use this on a fire a few times. The advantage of that is clearly you can save the weight of the stove and fuel entirely and just use the resources that are around. The downside is, especially in the state where I live, in California, you don't have a lot of options for when and where you can do that. You're basically going to be limited to winter to spring in terms of when you can have an open fire out in the mountains. It's for good reason. Totally respect it, but it does mean that you're limited in when you can do this. Oh, another limitation is you can almost never do this above 10,000 feet. And since I do a lot of backpacking above 10,000 feet, not really an option anymore. Sort of an option, not really an option. Backpacking without a stove and just using a fire, still a thing you can do. In much of the country, it's still an option. All right, now if you've gotten lost in all the mumbo jumbo, you're gonna either go with the lightest option or something that's kind of a compromise. And the lightest option is always gonna be an alcohol stove. It's convenient to refill if you're just doing weekend trips, and that's why I often use it. If you're gonna go on a longer hike, it's easier to work with and often just as light. Use one of these little stoves that fits on top of the canister. Many people like them in addition to that because you can get a little bit of a simmer out of them. They still have a hot spot in the middle, but if you want to simmer some soup for a little bit or something like that, you've got more flexibility than you do with this guy. And then the gourmet ultralight option is something like this, which honestly is only a few more ounces than something like either of these, but gives you the ability to simmer at a lower temperature and have a much larger pan on there while maintaining a stable cooking surface. Just to recap the vessels, a 550 milliliter cup is probably your lightest option. Then if you're going to do larger meals, 850 milliliters to 1.2 liters with a small pot gives you some cooking surface to fry stuff in the bottom of it, but you're still typically just going to be boiling stuff. You just have a more capacity to do larger meals, like a whole box of mac and cheese and things like that. If you're going more gourmet, something like this, the fry bake is really nice because it gives you the flexibility to cook all kinds of things that might not be an option. And something like this, you can still do your macaroni and cheese, but you can also do cobbler or cake or things like that. And then if you want something light but still need a good size cooking surface for cooking up some fish, this is the way to go. Almost forgot the accessories. With pretty much any of these, I'll probably use a cutoff spoon like that. This is just something I picked up at REI and hacked off. This is the best spatula that I found. I bought it from the same company that does the fry bake. It's small, it's stiff, and it's got a sharp edge on it. It's good for scraping. As far as pot grabber go, this is my favorite. It's an MSR. It's light, it grabs well, and that's about all I care about. The alcohol stove, I use little squeezy bottles and it's pretty straightforward. I can refill it and I never end up with the problem you have with isobutane stoves where the canisters only got 2/3 of the fuel you need and you have to get a new canister and you have all these half empty canisters lying around because you can't refill them. And that's really it. Got a lot of stuff here. You got the gist of how all these things work and what they're good for. So if you have any questions, feel free to comment, feel free to ask. I can do some follow-up videos to go into the details of how I use each of these things, some recipes, whatever sounds good. You let me know what you want and we'll talk through it. Till then, sayonara.